So, welcome to this webinar, Modeling Bikes in PDV Visum. My name is Annette Ehlert and I'm part of the Technical Product Management team. The webinar will last approximately 50 to 55 minutes and I would like to start with an agenda. I have divided the webinar into two parts. The first one is an introduction, including the motivation why cycling has become important. So this will be underlined with some numbers and figures. In the second part, I will talk about transport models and how to make them fit for assessing bike traffic. So this will also include a demonstration in the software. I thought that this statement is a good starting point, even if it is in German. So I will translate the headline first. The statement comes from the website of the Manager magazine and says that sales of bikes have exploded. Manufacturers have a hard time to serve the demand for bicycles and therefore cut holidays for their employees during the summer. So this statement came out in July, 2-3 months after the first peak of Corona in Europe. So what does it tell us? Corona is just another driver for an increased bicycle demand because the bike is perceived as an alternative to public transport to avoid crowded vehicles. But also without the pandemic, cycling is changing. The number of bicycles is growing. We just saw a proof of that. The mix of bike is changing. Years ago, we only talked about conventional bikes. Now there are also e-bikes or sometimes called pedelecs. The pressure for climate-friendly transport grows. Air pollution has become a problem in many cities. And also bikes are easier available. Mobile devices allow easy access to sharing offers. Bikes are often available around the corner. So I would underline the previous statements with some results from Germany, namely the MID. MID stands for Mobility in Germany and it's a national survey carried out at irregular intervals. The last MID took place in 2017. The results I present are from an extract focusing on slow modes. So what do the results say? One of the outcomes is that more kilometers are traveled by bike. So this is also confirmed by an increase in daily distances traveled and by the average length of bike trips that has also increased. So this is shown on the table on the top right. The average trip length by bike has increased by 20% to 3.8 kilometers. So the average trip length across all modes has increased by 24% to 12.5 kilometers. So the changes in modal split differ depending on the area and size of the city. The share of bike trips has increased in metropolitan areas. So the biggest increase is in metropolis, with 6% and in big cities with 4%. So in low density areas, the share is stable or has decreased slightly. So the exact numbers can be seen on the right in the table. So the upper part of the table refers to metropolitan areas and the part below to rural areas. So it shows a comparison between the last, between the results of the last two MIDs. The number of bicycles has increased in Germany from 70 million to 70 million. And the average number of bikes per household is nearly constant. So this number is 1.9. But we have to say this figure is constant because the share of households with people over 65 has increased. And typically, this type of household has less bikes than other types, like family households or households with younger adults. So with regard to the types, Pedelecs are recorded for the first time in 2017. There are a number of observations with regard to Pedelecs. Trips by Pedelecs are on average longer than by conventional bikes, so that is what we all would expect. You can see this on the right in this figure. So this is the case for all age groups. And for older persons, the difference is slightly bigger. Younger people use Pedelecs to go to work, whereas older people use Pedelecs rather for trip purpose leisure. And another observation is that Pedelecs are more frequently used in medium and small towns, so that is typically the areas where the share of bike trips is stable or slightly decreasing. So it's always useful to look for good examples. So I was in Copenhagen some years ago, and I was very impressed by the number of cyclists, by the widths of cycle tracks, by queues of bikes at intersections, which were often longer than the queues of cars. Despite being the number one of city of cyclists and many achievements, there are still ambitious goals. For example, increasing the share of bike trips for work and education to 50%. This share is currently 41%. So you find other goals in this box. These goals are expressed in different quantities, like a decrease in travel time or the number of cycle tracks. But often these goals also refer to the perception of cycling. On the top right is a list of reasons why people in Copenhagen cycle. The box below tells us what would make cycling more attractive. So what are the conditions under which people would cycle more? So all these figures come from the website cycling-embassy.dk, which lists several facts and figures about cycling in Copenhagen. So what is shown here is just an extract. So, but what is important? What can we learn from cities like Copenhagen? So my conclusions would be, there is a clear vision of what to achieve. There is a clear understanding of what people prevents from cycling. And there are often high standards for cycling facilities. And there are indicators that mean being able to also measure achievements. So by now we have seen that cycling is becoming more important and has a huge potential to have a bigger impact in many areas, including transportation. And therefore, cycling must get more attention when modeling traffic. So this brings me to the second part, modeling bikes. So in this part, I focus on transport models and modeling bikes in transport models. So the first question we should ask ourselves is, how does cycling differ from motorized modes? So we learned earlier that the average bike trip in Germany is 3.8 kilometers. So that is considerably shorter than trips by motorized mode. So that is the first difference. There are also other differences compared to the car. So cyclists do not always choose the shortest path. Difference two. So, but that is what we assume for car traffic in models. The third difference is capacity restrictions hardly play a role. For cars, we typically use volume delay functions to model the influence of volume on travel time. For bikes, this is rarely applicable. And referring to the difference that cyclists do not always choose the shortest path, the preferences among cyclists vary. So there are safety-related aspects. Many people do not cycle because they are scared of traffic. Comfort plays a role, and attractiveness. There are probably many cyclists that prefer a cycle path through a park or along a river compared to using the main road. So what benefits does a transport model have? How can transport models help to replicate the behavior of cyclists better? On the one hand, I would argue that travel demand models have already some benefits. So they often include motorized and non-motorized modes. The results are calibrated based on observed data. So that means that trip distribution and modal split, including bike, are often well reproduced. The models include structural and demographic data. So for example, the origins and destinations and some important characteristics of person groups. So for example, age, sex, employment, car availability, and so on. So disaggregated results are available from these models. So typically by person group, by trip purpose, and by mode. And most strategic models are updated regularly. So these updates concern both the infrastructure, so the supply side, and the demand side, including the data required for demand calculation. So this already provides valuable information for the planning process, even for cycling. However, on the other hand, for most travel demand models, it is also true that the demand for cycling is not assigned because routing is less important. So, and as a consequence, these models are often not suitable to evaluate measures focusing on cycling. So the question is, what must be done to allow the transport model to be used for cycling projects? So what are the steps? So they can be summarized in four steps. If a demand model is available, you can analyze the current situation, for example, with the objective to derive measures for certain user groups and or by trip purposes. So it is necessary to consider a refinement of the zone structure to realistically capture bike volumes. So in a strategic model, many bike trips are represented as intra-zonal trips. They cannot be assigned to the network. The network model, so the supply side, must be enhanced with the objective to include the factors that influence route choice and impedance respectively. And bike demand should be assigned to the network so that varying preferences among cyclists are reflected. So now we have a look at each of the steps. So what do we know already from a travel demand model? So let's assume we have a well-calibrated macroscopic demand model. So such a demand model contains a lot of information that can be analyzed for the mode bike. So as an example, let's take the person group students. So on the picture on the right side, we can see, for example, the origins and destinations of students that cycle to university. So you see in dark purple the places where university parts are located, and in a light purple you see the home locations of students. So we can analyze which are the relations with the biggest and lowest bike demand of students who cycle to university. So of course this corresponds a bit to the destinations and origins. So of course the demand from the south is quite high, and as the destinations there are the university locations. So we can also analyze the modal split of students in each zone and see in which area which mode dominates. So like here you can see a clear difference between the south part and the west part. So in this screenshot in blue we have mode bike, orange mode car, and green public transport. And you can see that here in the south, the mode share of bike is much higher compared, for example, to this western part. So this can already be analyzed from a travel demand model. Refinement of zone structure. Why might this be necessary? The zone size determines the number of trips that are assigned to the network. The bigger the zones, the higher the share that are represented by intra-zonal trips. So, of course, we know that bike trips have a higher share at smaller distances. With an increased distance, this share falls. So, if bike demand is assigned to the network, the zone size must be defined in an appropriate way. So, this could play an important role, for example, when comparing model volumes of bike traffic with counts that you might have available. So I have found a value of 2 square kilometers as a recommendation. So this number comes from a guideline for cost-benefit analysis of fast bicycle routes, or sometimes they are called expressways for bikes. So again, in this publication, it is argued that bike trips are of interest up to a distance of possibly 8 kilometers. So, and therefore, a zone size of 2 square kilometers is suggested. However, this may vary depending on the land use and the zone. So, why is it that networks of transport of a transport model are not sufficient for modeling cycling? First of all, this is lack of information or insufficient routing. So, when you import data, they often do not include network characteristics for cycling. At least they are not complete. So we often focus on motorized modes, such as car and public transport. The road network for these modes is not sufficient to model the route choice of cyclists. So, and of course, this often also applies to older transport models. They may need to be updated too. So a requirement is that the complete route network available to cyclists must be included in the model. So this includes bridges, tunnels, cycle paths, crossings that might be open for bikes and pedestrians only. So sometimes short additional links that represent such elements make a huge difference for the route choice of cyclists. Cycle paths away from the road network must be coded too as additional links for bikes. And one-way roads may be open for cyclists in the opposite direction. So these elements are typically represented by additional links, so that means they require extensions to the network. So on the other side, qualitative characteristics important to cyclists must be added. So this can be done by additional user-defined attributes for links, nodes, and turns. So examples of this qualitative characteristics are cycling facilities or the road surface. So for these characteristics, it is useful to apply a suitable classification consistently over all network elements. So the objective is then to assign bike demand to the network and replicate route choice more realistically, so capturing preferences among cyclists. So once the characteristics are coded in the network model, they can be used in the impedance definition for bike and consequently also in the assignment. So what are the factors that influence route choice of cyclists? So travel time and distance are often used already. Road surface and slope are factors for which we expect an influence on travel time. But then there are factors such as the type of cycling facilities, for example, cycle routes, bike lanes, bike passes. So they are valued differently by cyclists with respect to safety, attractiveness, and comfort. And then there are other elements such as signposting for cycle routes, parking facilities, areas of traffic calming, or also the possibility to take bikes on public transport. So all these factors have a positive or negative influence on cycling. So in the context of a model, or more specifically, an assignment, they can increase or decrease the impedance. So some of these factors are easier to incorporate into a model than others. So this, for example, includes factors like the road surface or cycling facilities, whereas other factors like covered parking facilities, image campaigns, signposting are hard or impossible to model. So let's focus on the factors that can be incorporated into a model. Over the last decade or so, some studies have been carried out that investigated some of these factors. For some, relationships have been established. For other factors, the correlation is less clear. So, of course, more of these studies would definitely help to improve our models. So I have grouped some of the factors into categories. Left are factors that increase impedance. So these are, for example, a positive slope, links with a road surface with a high rolling resistance. Then there are certain bike facilities or the non-existing of such facilities, so where cyclists share the space with other road users. The influence of the speed of motorized traffic, if it is very high, has a negative influence, but also the number of intersections that are to pass on a bike trip. On the right, you find factors that have a decrease the impedance. So this could be continuous routing. So if you travel on dedicated infrastructure elements, such as cycle paths, bike lanes, if you have areas of low speed, so traffic calming areas, for example, or they also dedicated signals or areas at intersections where cyclists have an advantage at the intersection. So now I will go through some of these factors in more detail, and also later on I will show you in the software how to model them. So the influence on slope on cycling is probably best known, and all the survey results confirm that. So this picture again comes from the survey Mobility in Germany, and it shows the share of bike trips based on the gradient in the area. So the share of bike trips is high in areas with a gradient below 5. And vice versa, the percentage of trips is low if the gradient is above 15%. So here are shown the shares of bike trips in dark blue, and pedestrians are also shown in lighter blue. Different cycling facilities are rated differently by users. So best rated are dedicated cycling facilities like cycle roads or cycle paths. And on the very other end, there is, for example, mixed traffic on roads and sidewalks, where cyclists share the space with other users. So the type of the cycling facility has an influence on the behavior of the cyclists. So, and that is what we would like to incorporate in an assignment, and therefore it requires to be coded in the network. So cycling facilities can be classified on different levels. So these classifications can usually be found in recommendations for cycling facilities. In Germany, these recommendations are a set of technical guidelines for planning, design, and operation of cycle facilities. So, and when you add qualitative characteristics to the network, it is good practice to classify cycle facilities in line with these local guidelines. So, and then also important is that the classification must be applied consistently for the entire network. So on the slide here, we see three different levels to classify cycling facilities. At the highest level, we distinguish between separated and mixed traffic. At an intermediate level, we additionally differentiate between mixed traffic, so all use the same space, and mixed traffic, whereas the space is somehow divided by road markings, for example. And at a very detailed level, we have further categories. So, for example, for separated facilities, there are cycle roads. Then there are cycle paths on each side of the road, one directional, on one side of the road, two directional, and so on. There could be further subclasses. So if in a model you use a detailed classification, you have the option to model the influence on impedance also at that level. So I will use later in my demonstration the medium level. So here we distinguish, as I was showing you before, between mixed traffic, so cyclists share the space with cars, then we have mixed traffic, whereas it is separated somehow by road marking. So in this category, a bike lane falls, for example, and then we have separate cycle paths. So the same could be done for road surface. Road surface with a high resistance increased travel time, so or generally impedance. And also for the road surfaces, a classification can be used. So here we have one example of a classification. We distinguish between asphalt, gravel, and cobblestone. So this classification is then applied to the network, and for each type, a factor with the influence on travel time is defined. So that I will show you later on. So where to get this information? This is sometimes not easy. There are different types of maps. So there are aerial maps and also OpenStreetMaps that might be useful. But these maps, they often do not include the complete characteristics for cycling. So local journey planners for cycling are often a good reference and could help to model these facilities or this information. So in the following demonstration, the software, I would like to show you how to better code a network for cycling and how to incorporate the information in the impedance and how to assign bike traffic to the network. So for that, I would like to change to Visum. So I would like to start with slope. In order to define slopes, you need z-coordinates. So here we use our example network, which is Halle, a town in Saxonia-Anhalt. So the town is not especially hilly, but there is a bit of an elevation in the northern part. So we have a couple of z-coordinates defined in that area. So in order to get the slope, we can use a special function for links. So we go to multi-edit, special function, and choose here calculate slope from z-coordinates. Then you choose a length attribute. And in your link list, then we have calculated the slope for corresponding links. So that is what we have seen, what we see here. So far slopes. The next thing I'll show you are the definition of additional characteristics of links that are relevant for cycling. So for that, typically user-defined attributes are used. So I will begin with road surface and use the classification I have shown you before. So in Visum 2021, we have user-defined tables to store more information in the model. So I will use these tables to define the classification. So then I do have this information in the network and can use it later on. So first I'd like to define such a table. So let's call it pavement. I will add it to a group for cycling. Now I will need two columns, one for the name for the classification and the second one for the factor. And in my classification, there are three different classes. So now I have these table. I can rename the column headers. So for example, here I will use a name. And for the second column, I will use factor. So this will be a floating point number. Okay, and I would like to see also the decimal places. So here I can first set up my classification. As I was showing you previously, I use here asphalt, gravel, and cobblestone. And then I can here define the factors, the influence on travel time. So I assume asphalt, there's no influence. For gravel, there's an increase of travel time, and the same applies to cobblestone. So now I have this classification in my model. So, but of course, I need to define links with that information. So I also need some user-defined attributes for links. So this will be here now pavement number. So this will refer to the user-defined table. By default, I set the class 1, which means asphalt. And I also add a link attribute, a user-defined attribute for the factor. So this will be of type floating point number, and the default value will be 1, that corresponds to asphalt 2. So if I go back to the link list, you will see that here now for all my links. So now I'm more or less ready to code my network. So let's assume here in the city center of Halle, there are some links which have a surface cobblestone. So I will code these links. So let's assume here 4 links. I will assign the corresponding number of the class. So in this case, this will be class 3, corresponds to cobblestone. So now I can go on and code all the links that are different from asphalt. And once I have done that, I can update the factor of the links using the information here in the user-defined table. So how do I do that? Again, I use a multi-add functionality. I define the target attribute. So that will be the link attribute pavement factor, and then I use a formula, more specifically a table lookup, that refers to my table definition. For pavement, I need a variable name, which I call p, and now I can define this table lookup. So here in the second part, I need to define a condition. So if the number of the pavement of the user-defined table corresponds to the link attribute pavement number, so if that is equal, then I use the factor from the user-defined table. So I add a p for the table and call it, use the attribute factor. So my target attribute is the user-defined link attribute. If the link attribute pavement number corresponds to the user-defined to the number in the user-defined table, then I use the factor and update the link attribute. So that is what you see here now. I have updated the factor. You can use that as a multi-edit operation, and you can also include that in the procedure sequence. So you can really make sure that these factors are always up to date. The next thing which is also useful is to code the cycling facilities. So in this case, you would more or less proceed in the same way. So set up a new table. So this time we call it facility, add it to the same group, and again use two columns for a name and a factor. The number is also given. And we use a classification at the medium level. So there are three different classes. So again, I can, if I want, rename these columns. And would do the same with the second column. And then here I could define my classification. In this case, I said I use the medium classification, so we distinguish between mixed, where the space is divided, cyclists use the same space as cars. Then we have mixed, but somehow separated by, for example, road markings. And then we have separated facilities. So we distinguish between these three classes. And again, I could use here a factor and apply that. And after that, I define user-defined attributes for links. So in that case, it is the facility number. And maybe by default, I set it up as mixed traffic. And again, once I have done that, I can go into my network. And for example, I know in this case, there is a section where a bike lane has been added in both directions. So I would code these links with the corresponding information. So the facility number is 2, so it falls in the class mixed but separated by marking. That is a bike lane. And now I have basically defined the class for some links, and I would continue to do so for the rest of my network. So what we have seen so far is how to code different types of road surfaces. So the influence on travel time is specified by a factor that is different for each class. Cycling facilities are coded in a similar fashion. So first we set up a classification and then code a link attribute according to this classification. And again, a factor can be used to model the influence on impedance. So this factor can decrease the impedance for attractive types of cycling facilities. So for example, for cycle roads or separated cycle paths, the factor can be below 1. And for mixed traffic, the factor is greater than 1. So for example, increases impedance. So basically this factor reflects the attractiveness of the facility. So the definition of the type of facility can also be used as a basis to define the influence of car traffic on cyclists. So we could assume that this influence does not exist for facilities separated from the road traffic, but for mixed traffic and mixed traffic but separated by marking, this influence is present. So remember, there was one thing was the speed of motorized traffic that has an influence on the impedance, and also high traffic volumes have a negative impact on cyclists. So the assumption is that the influence differs depending on the type of facilities. So we would define two different curves. that show how the factor changes with speed. So the blue curve refers to mixed but separated by marking. And the other curve refers to mixed traffic. So we can see that this factor is higher than for facilities separated by marking somehow. And we also see that a speed below 30 does not have any influence. So, and then we, of course, we could do the same thing for the traffic volume. Also here, we would assume the higher the traffic volume on the road, the higher is the factor and the more increases the impedance. So now let's go back to our model. So based on the combination, so let's assume now we have coded the network and this network has now incorporated different characteristics of cycling facilities, and based on the combination of characteristics, the cycle conditions can be assessed. So we have multiplied the corresponding factors from the different characteristics. They are shown here, for example, in this impedance factor for cycling. So in other words, the value of this attribute incorporates some qualitative characteristics. And additionally, we have now also modeled a factor for the car speed for certain cycling facilities. So by this factor, impedance factor, free flow speed. So you can see here, for example, the factor is 1 for free flow speeds of 30 and increases slightly for higher speeds. So, and both factors together are used then to calculate what is called here the overall impedance factor for bike. So that is a formula attribute that is always up to date. And once this link attribute is defined, the definition of impedance is straightforward. So this is done in the general procedure settings where we go to impedance. For bike, we use a detailed definition. And for links, what we do is basically use the travel time multiplied by the combination of these factors, which is included in this attribute. So, and we would do the same thing for turns. So, but here the travel time in the unloaded network is also incorporated in this user-defined attribute. So that is done more or less in the same way. So once the user-defined attributes are coded, you can display the characteristics of the cycle infrastructure in the network. So here, for example, we can see an assessment based on the coded cycle conditions. So here we distinguish between three classes. There are a fourth class where are links which are not assessed. So you can have here a color-coded network that shows the conditions for cycling. So how can this be used? This can be, for example, used in shortest path search. If you, for example, investigate major relations for cycling. So like here, we have a shortest path search between two zones. So that is based on the impedance now. And in the list of links, so we have included all the links that are crossed by this path. So you can see here, for the different links, the cycle condition. So, and then of course you could do that in the opposite direction. And also here you would see, in this example, you have, for example, two, even if they are short, there are two links with bad cycle conditions. So there might be something that can be done for that. So this can be used, for example, in this way. So the next thing I would like to show you is the assignment for assigning bicycle demand, we use the, or we recommend the stochastic assignment because this assignment is most suitable for cycling because it accounts best for varying preferences among the cyclists. So this assignment produces a set of routes, and besides the shortest paths, there are some further paths that are also generated, and these paths will be chosen with less probability but will be loaded with some demand. So now we go into the parameters and go through the different settings. In the basis tab, you see here a maximum iteration of 1, and that is because impedances do not depend on the volume for cycle traffic. That is the assumption behind that. In the impedance tab, currently you see the reference to the general procedure settings, which we have set previously. The smoothing tab can be ignored due to the fact that we have only one iteration. In the search tab, the most relevant parameter is the sigma. This has an influence on the number of routes found in addition to the shortest path. So the larger the parameter is, the more alternative routes are found. So in the search tab and in the pre-selection tab, so there are further parameters, like here the detour test and here the pre-selection conditions, that have an influence on the final set of routes on which the demand is distributed. So this is the choice set. Here you have the parameters for distribution. So now I would like to show you the assignment result that is here already calculated. So now we have one more information. In the stochastic assignment, there's also the option to define a route-based impedance component. So that is also in the parameter settings. I will come to that later again. And on this slide, you can see two examples where this might be useful. So one is the slope. So this is based on the assumption that not the slope of each link has an effect, but the link with the maximum slope on the path. So this can be done using a route-based component. And the second example is this option could also be used for modeling continuous routing. So continuous routing has a positive effect on cycling. So that means cyclists prefer to travel and continue on dedicated cycle facilities, for example, dedicated cycle routes. So in this case, we could define a route-based impedance component. So based on the share on the dedicated cycle route. So you would have calculated the share, the length on the cycle route, divided by the total length of the path, that gives a share. And based on the share, you have a factor that expresses the influence on the impedance here. So the higher the share, the higher the share, the less the impedance is increased. So also this I would like to show you in Visum. So this is here in the impedance tab. You can define here an additional component. So as I was mentioning before, you could go to links, maximum, and choose the slope. And based on that, you could define a condition how the slope increases the total impedance. So this could have a formula here. And then I would like to show you another example for the continuous routing. For that, I would like to use a demand um, a matrix that has only a single relation. So I would like to assign that. So this is, we look at the list of paths. So there are 6 paths between these two zones, 250 to 90. There are 6 different paths. 2 of them are fairly high loaded. Then there are 2 intermediate, and 2 of them have nearly no volume. And now I would like to introduce a cycle route. So that is marked here. And based on that, I would assume that the higher the share on the cycle route, the less is the impedance, so more users or cyclists find this traveling on the route more attractive. And as I was saying before, this can be incorporated also as a route-based impedance component. So this is shown here. That is a longer formula. So here you have the share, so that is the length on the cycle route divided by the length of the total path. And then we have defined a function, and in order to apply that, I change the coefficient and assign traffic again. And what you see here is what we would expect if that has an influence on the impedance. So the demand on these paths that cross these cycle routes are now higher compared to the ones that were previously used more. So this was a small demonstration of that option. So I did not talk much about intersection and coding for intersections. So in principle, you can use a similar approach. So you code the infrastructure, or you have already attributes for that. And from the values of these attributes, you derive the effects on impedance in the same way as we were saying before for links. So attributes of relevance could be the control type, the turn type. You could also use the volume of conflicting car traffic that has an influence on the impedance, and the existence of special infrastructure, for example, in front of the stop line. And then you end up again with the impedance for turns. And some further information. When we talk about cycling and modeling cycling, this also includes the combination of cycling with other modes for some time already, bike sharing, and also the possibility to take bikes on public transport. Vehicles can be modeled in Visum. However, precondition for these combinations is also a well-coded cycle network and taking the relevant effects in the assignment into account. You can already find examples in the installation for bike sharing and for taking bikes on public transport. So that is a multimodal assignment. And we will also provide soon an example for modeling bikes in Visum. So with this information, I would like to finish this webinar. I hope this webinar was of interest to you. Thank you very much for your attention.